Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling. In this video, we will learn about the concept of exception and the concept of exception handling in general life. In normal life, an exception is an unexpected event which disturbs the normal flow of execution. For example, your normal plan is, you are driving a car and you will keep on driving. This is your normal plan for a day, but while driving a car, an exception may occur and one tire of a car can get punctured. If this type of exception occurs, then you cannot drive the car. So driving a car is the normal flow, and if a tire got punctured, this is an exception. Exception can only occur when you are driving the car. Means if the tire is punctured before you start your car, then you will not start the car and you will not go on the driving. So there will not be any exception while you are driving. Exception only can occur when you are executing your process, when you are doing something. Exception only may occur at the runtime of a program, not at the compile time. Does not matter exception will occur or not, we must should be ready to handle an exception. During the journey, we must should have at least one extra tire. So before journey, if we make sure that we have at least one extra tire, means we are almost ready to handle the exception which may or may not occur during our journey. So having at least one extra tire is a kind of exception handling. Handling an exception is called exception handling. Purpose of exception handling is not to cure the exception, but to find a different way so that we can complete our rest of execution. Purpose of having this extra tire is not to cure that puncture tire, but purpose of having this extra tire is to complete our journey even if we have one tire got punctured. We are not going to cure the puncture tire, but we will change the tire. After changing the tire, we can complete our rest of the journey. An exception can be identified only at the runtime. Our tire only can get punctured when we start our journey. If our car is at the home and its tire got punctured, then this is not an exception for our journey because our journey has not been started yet. Exception only occurs at the runtime, not at the compile time. So I hope you got the idea of exception. And the exception handling is not about curing the exception, but to find a different way to complete our rest of the execution. I hope you got the idea of exception and you got the idea of exception handling. That's all for this video guys. Don't forget to like and share this video. Subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. In the previous video of this session, we already have learned about the concept of exception in the real life. Now we will learn about the concept of exception in Java. How an exception can occur in Java. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. In Java, we can have such a code which causes exception at the runtime. Exception can never occur at the compile time. Exception only occurs at the runtime. So in Java, we can have such a code which can cause the exception at the runtime. For example, if we are trying to access a remote file and in between the computers get disconnected from the network. So this is an exception for the Java program. The Java program was trying to access a remote file and in between the computer get disconnected. This is an example of the exception in Java program. The other example is division by zero. If we try to divide an integer by zero, then this is an exception. Division by zero is an exception in Java. If such an arithmetic expression is present in our code, then the compiler cannot predict it at the compile time. If such arithmetic is present in our code, then at the runtime, we get the exception and our program will stop execution. We will use this code in our program in a while. We must have to handle such exceptions, otherwise the program will get an abnormal termination. It is similar to that in a car journey, your tire got punctured and you do not have any extra tire. In that time, if you do not have the handling code, if you do not have the extra tire, then your program of journey get an abnormal termination. This is the program where we are using the arithmetic operation integer 8 divided by integer 0. And at the runtime, this statement will throw an exception java.lang.arithmeticException. Before the statement causing exception, we are printing a string statement 1. And after the statement causing exception, we are printing the string statement 2. Exceptions occur at runtime and destroy the normal flow of execution. Here the method main gets terminated abnormally after exception. And if an exception occurs, then the rest of statements does not get printed. So in this case, if we compile the Java file first dot Java, it will compile fine. And then if we execute the class first, then it will print the string statement 1. After that, the JVM will throw an exception. Exception in thread main, java.lang.arithmeticException, division by 0. So at the line number 6 of first dot main, here, we got the exception. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. Java C first.java. It compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It prints the first statement, statement 1, and then after the JVM throws an exception. java.lang.arithmeticException, division by 0. But there is a catch. Let me change in the code. If I write here 0.0 instead of just 0, then the calculation becomes a double calculation, because 0.0 becomes a double. So the result of this calculation is now double. And for the division of 0, in the calculation of the data type double, the JVM will not throw any exception, but this expression will result in infinity, a infinity of type double. We already have talked about this concept in the session 2 of Java and Web, primitive variables, data types and operators. You go to the playlist section of this channel, there you can find the session 2 of Java and Web. Let me try to execute this code. Java C, first.java. Now run it. Java first. Instead of throwing an arithmetic exception, here we have the output infinity. Let's make some more changes in the code and write here 8.0 divided by 0. Again, this expression will result in infinity, because since at least one operand is double, so data type of whole expression will result in double. Let me try to compile and execute this code. Clear the screen. Java C first.java compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It runs fine. And instead of throwing an exception, it's printing infinity. So the exception caused by division by 0 only occurs if the expression results in integer, not in double or float. If you want a method to continue its rest of execution even after occurrence of exception, then the method must should handle the exception raised inside its body. In Java, we use try catch block for exception handling. We will learn about the try catch block and about the exception handling in Java in the next video of this session. That's all for this video, guys. Don't forget to like and share this video. Subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook, and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. In the previous video of the session 12 of Java and Web, we already have learned about the exception in Java. We have written a program in Java which caused exception at the runtime. Now in this video, we will learn about how to handle an exception if it occurs during runtime. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan, and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. In this video, we will learn about exception handling in Java by using try catch blocks, and we will also learn what happens if an exception remains unhandled. To handle the exceptions in Java, we use try catch block inside a method. Try catch block pair is a way to handle the exception by a method. If we have a try catch block pair inside a method and the statement which can cause an exception is inside the try block, here going on a journey by a car can cause an exception. The tire of the car can get punctured. So the statement, that means going on a journey by car, can cause an exception. So this statement should be present in try block. And inside catch block, we have some alternative for that exception. If tire of a car gets punctured during the journey, then we have an extra tire. So the statement which can cause an exception should be present in try block. Presence of a statement in the try block does not mean that the statement is 100% going to cause an exception. The statement having the probability of exception should present in the try block. And if the exception occurs, then we have the catch block, which contains alternative for the exception. Whatever the exception caused by the statement present in the try block should be thrown to the catch block. And inside the parameter of the catch block, we are catching the type of exception. So here we are catching the tire puncture exception. The type of exception in the parentheses of catch is a kind of class, and the variable e is a kind of reference variable. If the statement in the try block which may cause an exception caused an exception, then only the catch block will execute. But if the statement which may cause an exception did not cause any exception, then the catch block will not execute. That means during the journey, if the tire of your car is not getting punctured, then you do not need to change the tire. Let's use the try catch block pair programmatically in Java. Here we have the Java file first.java. The Java file contains the class first. Inside the class first, we have the method main. Inside the method main, our first statement is to print the string statement 1. Then after we have the try block. Followed by try block, we have the catch block. Inside the try block, we are printing the string try block 1. Then after we are using an expression which will cause runtime exception. After that, we are printing the string try block 2. When we compile this Java file and execute the corresponding bytecode, the first statement gets printed is the string statement 1. Then after the control goes to the try block and it prints the string try block 1. After that, this expression calls the exception, arithmetic exception. After getting the arithmetic exception or any type of exception, rest of the statements in the try block ignored by the JVM. So the program does not print try block 2. You can see here. Since this is an exception, so the control will go to the catch block. Whatever the type of exception thrown by the try block should be catched by the catch block. Since the exception occurs, so the execution of catch block starts. If the exception was not thrown by the try block, then the execution of catch block have not happened. Inside the catch block, it prints the string catch block 1. Then after whatever the result of 8 by 2 gets printed here, it's 4. And after that, the string catch block 2 gets printed here. After the execution of catch block, it prints statement 2. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java. And this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. Java C, first.java. It compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It runs fine and printing the same output. It is not printing the string try block 2. Main objective of the exception handling is graceful termination of program, even after exception occurred. As you have seen in the previous video, if we had not any exception handling code in our Java program, then our code stopped executing abnormally. But here, even if the exception occurs, then also our program is completing its execution gracefully. This is another Java code, first.java, which contains the class first. Inside the method main of the class first, the first statement is to print the string statement 1. Then after we have a pair of try catch blocks. Inside the try block, we are executing an expression which will cause arithmetic exception. And inside the catch block, we are ready to catch the exception which is arithmetic exception. So in this case, first the string statement 1 will be printed. Then this statement will cause an arithmetic exception. After getting the arithmetic exception at this point, the catch block will be executed and the string hello will be printed. After that, the statement 2 will be printed. So even if we have a statement which caused an exception, then also our program executed fine and completed gracefully. In this case, we have nothing inside the catch block. So in this case, the string statement 1 will be printed. This statement will cause an exception. The control will go inside the catch block. But inside the catch block, here we have nothing to print. So after that, the JVM will print the string statement 2. But what happens actually when exception arises? Here in this case, we are not handling any exception. Although here we have the statement which will cause the arithmetic exception, but we are not handling the arithmetic exception. We do not have any handling code for the exception. The execution of the corresponding bytecode has started by the JVM and various memory areas have created. Two among them are the stack and the heap. Inside the stack section, the stack frame of the method main has been created. For the first statement inside the method main prints the string statement 1. And for the second statement in the method main caused an exception. When the expression in this statement caused an exception, then an object of type of exception, that is the arithmetic exception, has been created in the heap, whose reference is present in the method main. Yes, arithmetic exception is a class which is present in the package java.lang. And whenever a statement caused arithmetic exception, object of the corresponding class, that is object of the class arithmetic exception, gets created in the heap, whose reference is present in the method caused exception. This is an arithmetic exception, so main creates an object of the class java.lang.arithmeticException. After creating an object of the exception class, the method main calls the JVM in the picture. The JVM asks the method who caused the exception. In this case, the method who caused the exception is the method main. So the JVM asks the method main, so you have an exception. The method main says, yes. JVM again asks, do you have the handling code? But method main does not have any handling code. The method main says, no, I do not have any handling code. JVM scolds the method main. Idiot, who is your caller? That means if an statement may cause an exception, that statement should be present in a try block followed by the catch block. Means the exception must should be handled by the corresponding method. That's how the JVM scolded the method main. Since the JVM asking the method main who is your caller, so the method main replies, you only. From the previous sessions of Java and Web, we know that the JVM calls the method main. That's how the method main replies to JVM, you called me. JVM says, okay, you give me the reference of the exception object. Whatever the exception object created in the heap, you give me reference of that object. I am calling my default handler. All the JVM has default handler, which gets executed if the corresponding method which actually calls the exception does not implement any handler. So in this case, the JVM will call the default handler. JVM calls default handler with exception object, which prints the output. What the output gets printed by this program, we already have seen in the previous video of this session. After exception, all the statements in the method main gets ignored and the method main gets destroyed by the JVM. The output of the default handler is exception in thread name. Here the thread name is main. A Java program may have more than one threads, but in this case we have only one thread and the thread name is main. That's how your output will be exception in thread main, name of the exception and the description of the exception. Then after the JVM prints the stack trace. Stack trace means the name of the method where exception can occur, and it will keep on printing all the callers of the corresponding method. That means if the method A calls the method B calls the method C and the method C calls the method D. The exception occurs in the method D, then the stack trace will print D, C, A, B. Names of all four methods which caused the exception, root of the exception and their callers, either direct callers or indirect callers. We will see more about the concept of a stack trace in this video in a while. So what happens if a program contains an statement which may cause exception? Control first goes inside the try block. If there is an exception, then the method in which exception occurs, that is the method main, will create an object of type exception. In this case, arithmetic exception. The class arithmetic exception is present in the package java.lang, whose object gets created by the method main, and pass the reference of the created object to the catch block. So reference of the created object of the class arithmetic exception passed to the catch block. The catch block stores object reference in the reference variable e and execute all the statements which has been written inside the body of the catch block. The catch block must should have exception reference e of the same type of exception, that is of the type arithmetic exception, which was occurred in the try block. Or the catch block also may have a reference variable of type exception, which is the parent class of the exception arithmetic exception. We will see about this concept in the coming videos of this session. In this case, the try block is throwing an exception arithmetic exception, but the catch block having a reference variable e of type null pointer exception. The null pointer exception is not same as the arithmetic exception, and neither the null pointer exception is a parent of arithmetic exception. Both the cases are not true. So in this case, the catch block will not execute and the program will terminate abnormally. See in the other cases, when the catch block has the reference variable e of type arithmetic exception and the try block also was throwing the arithmetic exception, does not have abnormal termination. But since here we are catching the object reference of type arithmetic exception into the reference variable of type null pointer exception, and the null pointer exception is neither same nor the parent of the arithmetic exception, so in this case the program will terminate abnormally. Here in this case, the method main calls the method abcd, and the method abcd has a statement which will cause arithmetic exception. Now let's check what will happen if we execute this code. The various memory areas of JVM got created, and two among them are the stack and the heap. The stack frame of the method main gets created in the stack area of the JVM. Then the method main prints the string statement 1. After that, the method main calls the method abcd. The method main pauses its execution and the stack frame of the method ABCD gets created into the stack area of the JVM. The first statement of the method ABCD prints the string statement A1. Then after the next statement of the method ABCD caused an exception. That's how in this case a statement in the method ABCD caused an exception. So the method ABCD creates an object of type arithmetic exception and having a reference variable of this object. Now the method ABCD have to call the JVM. The method ABCD calls the JVM and the JVM comes into the picture. The JVM asks the method ABCD, so you have an exception? Method ABCD says yes. Then the JVM again asks the method ABCD, do you have any handling code? The method ABCD says no, because the method ABCD does not have any handling code. So the JVM scolded the method ABCD, idiot, who is your caller? The method ABCD says, the method main is my caller. The JVM says, okay, you give me the reference of exception object, I will talk to the method main. And I am going to remove you from the stack without execution of your rest of statements. That's how the JVM removes the method ABCD from the stack. Then after the JVM asks the method main, hey method main, have you called the method ABCD? The method main says yes. Then the JVM again asks the method main, he caused an exception and he did not have any handling code too. So the method main says, oh, okay. The JVM says, do you have the handling code? The method main says, no, I do not have the handling code. JVM again scolded the method main, you are more idiot than him. Who called you? The method main replies, you only called me JVM. The JVM replies, okay, I have the reference of exception object. I am calling my default handler. JVM again scolded the method main and I am going to remove you from the stack without executing your rest of the statements. That's how the JVM removes the method main from the stack. And the JVM calls its default handler. The default handler prints the stack trace. And you can see here at this time, the stack trace got printed. First, it prints the method who actually called the exception, the method ABCD. Then after he prints the method who called the method ABCD, that is the method main. Name of these two methods are called stack trace. That's how overall output of the default handler is exception in thread main, java.lang.arithmetic exception, division by 0, and these are the two methods who caused exception. The main cause is the method ABCD, and the method main who calls the method ABCD also does not contain any handling code. In this case, the method main calls the method ABCD. The method ABCD calls the method F, and the method F caused the arithmetic exception. So first the JVM will remove the stack frame of the method F from the stack. Then the JVM will remove the stack frame of the method ABCD from the stack. And then the JVM will remove the stack frame of the method main from the stack. Because none of the three has the handling code. In this case, the output will be statement 1. Then it calls the method ABCD. It will print the statement A1. Then it calls the method F. Then it prints the statement F1. Has the end statement which caused arithmetic exception. So default handler of the JVM will print exception in thread main, java.lang.arithmetic exception, division by 0. The first method who caused an exception is the method F. The root cause of the exception is the method F. The caller of the method F is the method ABCD. The caller of the method ABCD is the method main. And none of the three has the handling code. That's how the program terminates abnormally. The section of the output by default exception handler means these three lines where it shows location of exception is called stack trace. Here in this case the execution starts from the method main and the first statement the method main prints is statement M1. Then after the method main calls the method ABCD. The first statement gets printed by the method ABCD is statement A1. Then the method ABCD calls the method F and the first statement got printed by the method F is the statement F1. After that we have the try block in the method F. Inside the try block, we have a statement which will cause arithmetic exception. But here the method F is handling the exception. The code which caused the arithmetic exception is inside the try block. So here the method F is handling the exception. The reference of the object of exception, arithmetic exception, passed to the reference variable E. And then inside the catch block, it prints statement FC. After that, the method F prints the statement F2. Here you can see the program has not terminated abnormally, but the program is continuing its execution. After printing the string statement F2, the control comes here and the program prints statement A2. Here the execution of the method ABCD is over and it's printing the string statement M2. This is a task for you to try this code practically. In this case, the method main calls the method ABCD. The method ABCD calls the method F in a try block. And the method F has a statement which calls arithmetic exception. Here the method ABCD takes the responsibility of exception handling. And the method which may cause an exception has been called from within the try block. Here also the execution starts from the method main. The method main prints the statement M1. Then it calls the method ABCD. Inside the method ABCD, it prints the statement A1. Then the control goes inside the try block. Inside the try block, the method F gets called. Inside the method F, the first statement is to print the string statement F1. After that, we have the statement which causes an arithmetic exception. Since the method F does not have any handling code, so the JVM will remove the stack frame of the method F from the stack and go to the method ABCD. But the method ABCD has the handling code. The method ABCD called the method F from within the try block. So reference of the exception caused here in the method F has been stored into the reference variable E. Since an exception is occurred in the method F, so rest of the statements in the try block will be ignored by the JVM. The execution of the case block starts and it prints statement ABCD. After that, it prints statement A2. The method F has not completed its execution and removed from the stack by the JVM. But here the method ABCD, since it was handling the exception, completed its execution. And after execution, the control result to the method main. After that, the method main prints the string statement M2. Here in this case, the method main calls the method ABCD from within the try block. So whatever exception is thrown by the ABCD will be handled by the method main. The method ABCD is calling the method F and the method F is printing a statement which will cause the arithmetic exception. So execution starts from the method main. The first statement of the method main prints the string statement M1. Then after in the try block of the method main calls the method ABCD. The first statement of the method ABCD prints the string statement A1. Then it calls the method F. In the method F, the first statement to be printed is method F1. And then the method F executes an expression which causes arithmetic exception. The arithmetic exception occurs in the method F. So the JVM removes the stack frame of the method F from the stack without executing its rest of the statements. Then after, the JVM asks the ABCD, do you have the handling code? Because you called the method F and the method F caused an arithmetic exception. So, do you have the handling code, Mr. ABCD? The method ABCD says, no, I do not have the handling code. So, in this case, the JVM also removes the stack frame of the method ABCD from the stack without executing its rest of the statements. Then after, the JVM goes to the method main and asks if he has the handling code or not, because the method main called the method ABCD. But since the method main has the handling code, so reference of the exception thrown by the method F will be stored into the reference variable E. That's how it prints statement main C. And finally, the last statement of the method main gets executed, statement M2. Since in this case, the method main has the handling code, so the program executed gracefully and do not terminated abnormally. If an exception occurs in the try block, then the rest of the statements in the try block gets ignored by the JVM. Here in this case, the execution starts from the method main, and the first statement of the method main prints statement M1. After that, in the try block, a statement causes arithmetic exception. After the statement which causes arithmetic exception, all the statements in the try block gets ignored and the control comes inside the catch block which prints the string statement catch. And finally, it prints the string statement M2. After exception, no other statement is going to execute in the try block. So keep the try block as minimum as possible. Place only risky code in try block. That's all for this video, guys. Don't forget to like and share this video. Subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook, and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. In the previous video, we have learned that if exception occurs, then the exception object gets created in the heap and the reference of the exception object gets stored into the reference variable e inside the parentheses of catch block. In the previous video of the session, we learned this concept by using arithmetic exception, but this is true for all the exceptions. There are some methods associated with all the exceptions in Java, which can be called by using the reference variable e. Here the type of exception does not matter. Same methods can be called by using the reference variable e. Does not matter what is the type of e. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. In this video, we will learn about various exception methods. Here in the Java file first.java, we have the class first, and inside the class first, we have the method main. Inside the method main, we have try catch block. Inside the try block, we have a statement which will cause arithmetic exception. Inside the catch block, we have created a reference variable of type arithmetic exception. So the reference of the object of arithmetic exception, which gets created because of this expression, gets stored into the reference variable e. And by using the reference variable e, we can call various methods. First method is print stack trace method. So the method print stack trace prints exception information, that is name, description and stack trace. Default handler internally use this method, because we know that the default handler also prints the same. Let me try to execute this code. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. Java C first.java, it compiles fine. Now run it. Java first, it runs fine and printing the name of exception, description of exception and the stack trace, the names of methods which cause the exception. Here we are using the reference variable e of type arithmetic exception. But the same statement is valid for all types of exceptions in Java. There is another method which we can call on the reference variable of type any exception. And here we are calling it on the reference variable of type arithmetic exception. The method name is toString method. When we call the method toString by using the reference variable of any exception type, then it returns exception information, that is only name and description. It does not print the stack trace. The method print stack trace automatically prints the output, but the method toString returns a string. It does not automatically print anything. So we need to call the method toString by using the reference variable e of type any exception under system.out.print or println statement. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java and change the code right here, e dot to string, put it inside system.out.println, e dot to string. Let me save and compile this code. Java C first.java, it compiles fine. Now run it. Java first, it prints only exception name and description. It does not print the stack trace. If we directly print the reference variable e of type arithmetic exception, then internally it calls toString method. And we know that the nature of the toString method on any exception is to print the name of exception and description of the exception. The other method is getMessage method. When we call the method getMessage by using the reference variable of any type of exception, then it only prints the description of the exception. It does not print the name of the exception. It does not print the stack trace. It only prints the description of the exception. Notice that here in this video, we are handling the exception. But inside the handling code, inside the catch block, we are calling these methods. If you do not handle the exception, then by default, the default handler calls this print stack trace method. Let's try this code practically. Open first.java. And right here, get message, e dot get message. Let me save and compile this code. Java C first.java, it compiles fine. Now run it. Java first, it runs fine and printing only the description of the exception. That's all for this video guys. Don't forget to like and share this video, subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. We use try catch block pair to handle the exception. If exception occurs, then the rest of the statements in the try block gets ignored, but all the statements of the catch block gets executed. And if the exception does not occur, then all the statements in the catch block gets ignored. But in both of the cases, the exception occurs or not, we may require some statement which should be executed. Does not matter if the exception occur or not occur. We may need a statement which should execute in both the cases. In that case, we need finally block. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Wave, Exception Handling in Java. In this video, we will learn about finally block in Java. We can have finally block under try catch block pair. Does not matter exception occurs or not. In each case, finally block will be executed. See here the example. If you are driving and your tire is not getting punctured, then you need to keep on driving. Means if the exception does not occur, then also the finally block should execute. Finally, you should keep on driving. But if the exception occurs, your tire got punctured, then you need to use the stepney, the extra tire with you, and you must continue your journey. So it does not matter the exception occurs or does not occurs. You need to continue your journey. So in the finally block, anyhow, you need to continue your journey. The finally block must should execute anyhow if the exception occurs or not occurs. We use finally block to place cleanup code inside it. For example, if the code have a network connection, then we can close it in the finally block. Complete try block does not execute if exception occurs. And catch block does not execute if exception does not occurs. So it is recommended to use finally block for cleanup. Finally block even ignores the return statement. So it is the best place for cleanup code. We will see it in a moment. This is the Java file first.java. And the first.java contains a class whose name is first. Inside the class first, we have the method main. Inside the method main, we are printing the first string statement m1. So the statement m1 gets printed here. Then after the control enter inside the try block, and inside the try block, we print the string statement try1. So it prints the string try1. Then after in the second statement, the expression causes arithmetic exception. So from here, our control goes to the catch body. Inside the catch body, we need to print the string statement catch. So it prints statement catch. Does not matter the exception occurs or not. The finally block always gets executed. So the body of the finally block will execute. And it will print the string statement finally. So it prints the string statement finally. And at last, we are printing the string statement m2. It prints the string statement m2. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java. And this is the same code as we have seen. Let me save and compile this code. Java C, first.java. It compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It runs fine and printing the same output. Here in this case, the exception does not occur. We are not doing any division by zero. So here in this case, first it will print the string statement m1. Then the control will be enter inside try block. And it will print the string statement try1. Then it prints the result of 8 divided by 2, that is 4. And inside the try block, we print other string statement try2. And it prints the string statement try2. Notice here that the exception does not occur in this case. So the catch block will not execute. This statement will not be printed. But does not matter the exception occurs or not, the catch block executes or not, we have to print the finally body. So the string statement finally gets printed. And at last we are printing the string statement m2. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java. And this is the same code as we have seen. Here this statement does not cause any arithmetic exception. The catch block will not execute. But anyhow, the finally block is going to execute. Let me try to compile this code. Java C first.java. It compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It runs fine and printing the same output. Finally block dominates return. Finally block executes before return statement in try. Here we have the Java file first.java which contains the class first. The class first has two methods, the method main and the method f. The method main calls the method f. Inside the method main, we are printing a string statement m1. And then we enter in the try block. Inside the try block, we are printing the string statement try1. and then we are printing the result of 8 divided by 2, that is 4. And you can see here, we have the return statement in the try block. Means hereafter, the execution of the method f should stop. But before stopping the execution of the method f, it prints a statement finally. That's how the finally block gets executed even before the return statement. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. You can see here, this is the same code as we seen in the slide. Let me save and compile this code. Java C, first.java, it compiles fine. Now run it, Java first, it runs fine and printing the same output. The finally block gets executed before the method f finishes its execution. Only one situation where finally block gets ignored is if we shut down the JVM by using system.exit method. System is a class which contains the static method exit. When we call the static method exit of the class system by using the actual argument 0, then JVM stops working. Here in this case, instead of writing here return statement, we are calling the method exit of the class system by using the actual argument 0. So from this point onwards, the JVM will stop working. And since the JVM stops working, so the finally cannot execute in this case. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Instead of return statement, here we are calling the method exit on the class system. Let's compile this code. Java C, first.java, it compiles fine. Now run it, Java first, it runs fine. And after printing 4, the JVM stopped working. That's all for this video, guys. Don't forget to like and share this video, subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook, and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. Statements which may cause exception should be placed inside try block. But the statements which may cause exception may also be present in the catch block or in finally block. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan, and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Wave, exception handling in Java. In this video, we will learn about flow of control in try catch finally block. This is a try catch block pair present in a method. Inside try, we have three statements, S1, S2 and S3. And inside the catch block, we have only one statement, S4. XYZ is a type of exception and E is a reference variable of type XYZ. And this is the statement S5. If there is no exception, then the order of execution will be S1, S2, S3 and S5. Since there is no exception in try block, so the catch block will not execute. But if there is an exception in S2, then the order of exception will be S1. In S2, there is an exception, so the statement S3 does not execute and the control goes into the catch block, where it executes S4 and finally it executes S5. So the overall statements to execute in this case is S1, S4 and S5. If there is an exception at S4 or S5, these two statements may also cause exceptions. If there is an exception in these two statements, then there will be abnormal termination of the program because these two statements are not under the try block. If an exception occurs in these three statements, then these three statements are in the try block, and for this try block we have a catch block. But if an exception occurs at the statement S4, then we do not have any try catch pair to handle the exception at the S4. And if an exception occurs at the statement S5, then also we do not have any try catch pair to handle the exception at the S5. Here in this case, we have the Java file first.java which contains the class first. Inside the method main of the class first, we have a try catch block pair. Inside the try block, we have the statement 8 divided by 0 which causes an arithmetic exception. And inside the parenthesis of the catch block, we have the reference variable E of type arithmetic exception. So the reference of the class arithmetic exception gets generated in the try block, stored in the reference variable E, and then execution of the catch block starts. It prints the string catch1, but thereafter there is a statement in the catch block which causes an arithmetic exception once again. And for this statement, we do not have any try catch block pair to handle this exception. The statement itself inside the catch block, but for this statement, we do not have any try catch block pair. So this exception is not going to be handled by our code. There is no handling code for this exception. So after this statement, the program terminates abnormally. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let's try to compile this code. Java C first.java, it compiles fine. Now run it. Java first, it prints the string catch one, and then after, the default handler gets called, which is printing the following output. Exception in thread main, the name of the exception java.lang.arithmetic_exception, description of exception division by zero, and the method which caused the exception. Let me make some changes in this code. Let's put the statement which caused exception inside the catch block in another pair of try catch blocks. Put the statement inside the try block. Write here try and put the statement inside try block. Then write here catch, name of the exception, create a reference variable of the exception which you want to catch, arithmetic exception, and the name of the reference variable will be E. You can name it anything else. You can name it O, it does not matter. Then right here catch block, inside the catch block print a statement and right here catch catch. Right here catch catch. Save and compile this code. Clear the screen. Java C first.java. It compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It runs fine. And at this time, it is also printing catch catch. That means if an exception occurs at this statement, then here we have the handling code. So a try catch is present inside the catch body. This one is the outer try catch and this one is the inner try catch present inside the catch body. The try catch may also present in the try body or finally body. Here we have the all try catch and finally blocks. If there is no exception, then order of execution will be S1, S2, S3. Since there is no exception, so the statement S4 will not execute and it will execute the statement S5, then S6. So overall order of the execution is S1, S2, S3, S5 and S6. If there is an exception at S2, then the order of the execution will be, first it will execute S1, then after S2 and S3 will not be executed. Since there is an exception at the statement S2, so the catch block will be executed. It will execute the statement S4 and finally anyhow is going to execute. So it will execute the statements in the order S1, S4, S5 and S6. If there is an exception at S4, S5 and S6, then in these three statements, we are not handling the exception. So there will be abnormal termination. If there is an exception at the statement S4, then also the finally block will execute. Miss the statement S5 inside the finally block will execute anyhow. Does not matter if the exception occurs inside the try block or the exception occurs inside the catch block. The statement S5 inside the finally block will execute anyhow. If you want to check it practically, then just use system.out.println statements and check the flow of control, the order of execution in try catch finally blocks. If there is no execution in this case, then the order of execution will be, first it will execute S1, S2 and S3, then the control will be entered into the block of try, the try inside the try. After that, it will execute the statements S4, S5 and S6. Since there is no exception in this inner try block, so the inner catch block will not execute. And the control comes in inner finally block and it prints the statement S8. After that, it prints the statement S9. So inside the outer try, the statements which got executed are S1, S2, S3, S4, S5, S6, S8, and S9. And since there is no exception in the outer try block, so the outer catch block does not execute. That's how the statement S10 does not execute. It executes the statement S11. Because the finally block of the outer try block anyhow has to execute. Since it does not matter the exception occurs in the outer try block or not, The outer finally block has to be executed. And finally, it executes the statement S12. So overall, this code will execute the statements S1, S2, S3, S4, S5, S6, S8, S9, S11, and S12. If there is an exception at the statement S2, then the order of execution will be, we are in the outer try block, and in the outer try block, we got an exception. So rest of the outer try block will not be executed. And the catch block corresponding to the outer try block will execute. Finally, block of the outer try block has to be executed anyhow. So the order of execution of statements will be S1, S10, S11 and S12. Because after getting an exception at the statement S2, the rest of the body of try block, the outer try block, has not get executed. And since exception occurs in the outer try block, so the catch block corresponding to outer try block has to execute. Finally, anyhow has to execute. If there is an exception at the statement S5, means here, then the order of execution will be, first the statement S1 will execute, then the statement S2 will execute, then S3 will execute, then after the statement S4 will execute, and we have an exception at the statement S5. Since the exception occurs at the inner try block, so rest of the body of the inner try block will not execute. That's how after the statement S4, the catch block corresponding to the inner try block has to be executed. So the statement S7 executes. Does not matter the exception occurs in the inner try block or not. The finally block corresponding to the inner try block has to be executed. So the statement S8 also executes. And statement S9 has to be executed. Since the statement S9 is a part of the outer try block and it has nothing to do with the inner try catch finally. So the statement S9 executes. Since there is no exception in the try block, the exception occurs inside the inner try block, not inside the outer try block. And internally inside the try block, the exception occurs at the S5 has been handled. So even if the exception at the S5 occurs, it is considered as the exception in the outer try block never happened. And since the exception in the outer try block never happened, so the corresponding catch block of the outer try block never execute. Does not matter the exception occurs in the outer try block or not. The finally block corresponding to outer try block has to be executed. And the statement S11 will execute. Finally, it will execute the statement S12. That's all for this video, guys. Don't forget to like and share this video. Subscribe my channel on YouTube. Like my page on Facebook. And leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. Various exception classes exist in the various packages of Java API. When an exception occurs in a code, then an object of corresponding class gets created. And reference to that object gets stored into the reference variable of exception type in the parentheses of catch block. In this video, we will learn about the concept of various exception classes and hierarchy among those classes. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. We know that whenever exception occurs in a method, internally that method creates an object of occurred exception. Means we must have a corresponding exception class whose object the method is creating. We have two types of exception classes in Java. First one is ready-made exception classes available with JDK. With Java API you can find all the ready-made exception classes. And the second one is custom exception classes. These exception classes created by programmers. Different exception classes in Java are organized in parent-child relationship. All the exception classes are either direct or indirect children of java.lang.throwable class. Means there is a class whose name is throwable, present in the package java.lang, and all the exception classes are either direct or indirect child of the class whose name is throwable. This graph represents parent-child relation between different exception classes. The class throwable is a child of the class object. We already have learned about the class object, the java.lang.object. Class throwable is also present in the package java.lang. There are two children of the class throwable. One is the class exception and other one is the class error. We will talk about the class error in the later videos of this session. Now we are talking about the class exception. You can see there are five children of the class exception. Runtime exception, IO exception, SQL exception, AWT exception and interrupted exception. And the exception arithmetic exception is a child of the runtime exception. In the session 12 of Java and Web, we are not going to cover all the exception classes and all the error classes. But we will cover these classes, the exception classes and the error classes, at the corresponding point when they are required. Till now in this session, we have used the arithmetic exception a lot. And the arithmetic exception is a child of runtime exception. The runtime exception is a child of exception. The exception is a child of throwable. And the throwable is a child of object. This graph shows the hierarchy of exception classes in Java. So now we know that arithmetic exception.class is a direct child of the runtime exception.class. So we can catch arithmetic exception object in reference of the class runtime exception. That means in the parentheses of catch block, here we are creating a reference variable of type runtime exception, not of type arithmetic exception. But inside the try block, our code is throwing an exception of type arithmetic exception. But since the runtime exception is parent of arithmetic exception, so the object reference of arithmetic exception can be stored into the reference variable of type runtime exception. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Here the arithmetic exception will be generated, which will be caught in the reference variable of type runtime exception. Let me try to compile this code. Java C first.java compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It runs fine. The exception has been caught. We know that the arithmetic exception.class is indirect child of throwable class. So we can catch arithmetic exception object in reference of throwable. That means here instead of creating a reference variable of type arithmetic exception, or instead of creating a reference variable of type runtime exception, we can also create a reference variable of type throwable. Because the arithmetic exception class is an indirect child of the throwable class. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and instead of creating a reference variable of type runtime exception, create an object of type throwable. T-H-R-O-W-A-B-L-E. Throwable. Save and compile this code. Java C first.java compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It runs fine and the exception got handled. We cannot catch an exception object in such an exception reference which is not a direct or indirect parent of occurred exception. That means here the exception IO exception is not a direct or indirect parent of arithmetic exception. So here the arithmetic exception reference cannot be stored in the reference variable of type IO exception. And the compiler will throw an error. Inside the try block, object has been created is of arithmetic exception type. But we are catching it in reference variable of IO exception. That causes a compile time error. Let me try this program practically. Open first.java once again. And write here IO exception. IO exception. IO exception. To use the exception class IO exception, we need to import it from the package java.io. So import it from the package java.io. Import java.io.io exception. Now try to compile this code. Java C first.java compiler throws an error. Exception IO exception is never thrown in body corresponding to try statement. That means here we have never tried to throw any IO exception. Here we do not have any input output based operation, but we are trying to catch IO exception. Object.class is an indirect parent of java.lang.arithmetic exception class. But we cannot catch an arithmetic exception object in reference of type object. That means if here you write object then the compiler will throw an error. Let me try it. Java C first.java. It is showing incompatible types. Object cannot be converted to throwable. Object is not a throwable class. That means an object gets thrown only if it is throwable or its children, and can be catched only in reference variables of throwable or its children. and can be cached only in the reference variables of throwable or its children. That means only object of those classes can be thrown as exception, which are throwable or children of throwable. We cannot throw the object of the class object as exception. What is null pointer exception? Till now, we used only arithmetic exception. Let's generate a null pointer exception and catch it. Here we have the Java file first.java. The first.java contains two methods, the method main and the method fun. Inside the method fun, we are printing the string fun. Inside the method main, we have try catch block. Inside the block try, we have created a reference variable of type first and storing null inside it. Finally, we are calling the method fun on the reference variable of type first. But since the reference variable f does not contain the reference of any object, it is containing null. That's how in this case, when we try to call the method fun by using the reference variable f, we will get null pointer exception. We are catching that null pointer exception in the catch block. Inside the parenthesis of the catch block, we have a reference variable e of type null pointer exception. And finally, in the catch block, we are printing the string catch1. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java. And this is the same code as we have seen. Try to compile this code. Java C, first.java. Compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It runs fine and printing the output. Catch 1. Let me change the code. And remove the try catch block. I want the exception to terminate the program abnormally. So I am deleting the try catch block. Now again compile this code. Java C, first.java. Compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. The program throws null pointer exception. Exception in thread main. java.lang.nullpointerexception at first.main. Notice here that the method fun is not a static method. So because of this method call, which method body will execute gets decided at the runtime. But if the method fun is a static method, then what the method body will execute because of this method call will be decided at the compile time. So in this case, we will not get any runtime exception. Let me try this code. Open first.java. I am not going to catch the exception in this code. I just want the program to terminate abnormally if the exception occurs. But in this case, the exception will not occur because the method is static and the binding of the static method means the decision of which method body will execute because of which method call gets decided at the compile time. So right here static. Since the method body to execute because of which method call gets decided at the compile time. So according to the type of reference variable, they decide which method to execute. And type of reference variable can be decided at the compile time. So at the runtime, it does not check that reference variable contains null or address of an object. Anyhow, it will execute the method body. Let me try to compile this code. Java C, first.java, compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It runs fine and printing fun. But we cannot call the method fun on an uninitialized variable f. In this case, the compiler will throw an error. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java and just remove the initialization from this statement. Try to compile this code. Java C, first.java. The compiler throws an error. Variable f might not have been initialized. That's all for this video, guys. Don't forget to like and share this video. Subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook, and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. In this video, we will learn about throw keyword in Java. We already have seen this program in previous video of this session. Till now, whatever the programs we seen in this session, exception objects have been automatically generated in try blocks and thrown to catch blocks. All such activities were hidden from programmer's eye and was going behind the scene. That means here in this case, the creation of an object of type arithmetic exception and to store the reference of the object of type arithmetic exception in the reference variable e is actually behind the scene. We do not have any control on it. If there is a division by zero exception, then automatically an object of type arithmetic exception gets created here, whose reference will be stored into the reference variable e. Here a programmer does not have control on this activity, but we can explicitly create an exception object and can throw it explicitly to the catch block. To throw an exception object explicitly, we use throw keyword. Here in this case, we have the Java file first.java, which contains the class first. Inside the class first, we have the method main, which contains try catch block. Inside the try block, we have created an object of type null pointer exception, whose reference is stored into the reference variable n. And then by using the throw keyword, we are throwing the reference of the null pointer exception object to the reference variable e. This whole process was done automatically in this case with arithmetic exception object. But here, we are doing it manually with null pointer exception object. We can do the same with the arithmetic exception object also, or with any exception object. Since here we are throwing an exception by using the throw keyword, so rest of the statement in the try block will not be executed. And since an exception is thrown, that's how the catch block will be executed. The exception type in the parenthesis of the catch block should be either of the same type whose reference we are throwing from the try block, or should be of the base type whose reference we are throwing from the try block. So whatever the reference is stored into the reference variable n will be stored into the reference variable e. Finally, in the catch block, we are printing the string catch1. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. Java C first.java. It compiles fine. Now run it, Java first. It runs fine and printing catch1. Here we are creating an object of type arithmetic exception and throwing it to the catch block in the same line. So here in this case, the creation of an object of type arithmetic exception and throwing it to the corresponding catch block is in the same line. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and here in this case we are creating an object of type arithmetic exception, throwing the object reference of type arithmetic exception explicitly and storing it into the reference variable e of type arithmetic exception into the parenthesis of the catch block. Let me try to compile this code. Java C first.java compiles fine. Now run it, Java first. It runs fine and printing catch1. Now let's check the code once again and write here throw new arithmetic exception. Write here throw new arithmetic exception. Try to compile this code. Java C first.java compiles fine. Now run it. It runs fine and printing catch1. So here in this case, we have created an object of type arithmetic exception and thrown it to the corresponding catch in the same line. If we try to throw null reference of any exception or error, we will get null pointer exception. Here in this case, we are not catching the exception. Although by using the null reference of any type of exception with throw keyword results a null pointer exception. But here in this case, we are not providing the handling code for null pointer exception, because I want you to see the name of the exception in result of the default handler. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. I have commented out the try catch block pair. These two statements are freely inside the method main. There is no third statement in the method main. Let me try to compile this code. Java C first.java. It compiles fine. Now run it, Java first. It runs fine, and you can see here the default handler is printing an output exception in thread main java.lang.nullPointerException. Now let me remove all the comments from the code. Remove this comment, this one also, then this one, then remove the comment from the catch block. Remove this comment. Now try to compile it once again. Java C first.java compiles fine. Now run it, Java first. It runs fine and printing catch1. The null pointer exception has been thrown from the try block, which has been caught into the catch block, into the reference variable e. Now the catch block is printing the string catch1. Similarly, if we have a reference variable of type arithmetic exception which contains the value null, and we explicitly use the null reference with the throw keyword, in this case also the program will throw null pointer exception. So the type of exception does not matter. If the reference of exception contains null and we are throwing a null reference of any exception, it will throw null pointer exception. Here in the Java file first.java, we have the class first, and inside the class first, we have the static member AE, which is a reference variable of type arithmetic exception class. The default value of static reference variable is null. So in this case, if you try to throw the arithmetic exception AE, again it will throw the null pointer exception. While creating an object of any exception, we can provide the description of exception within parentheses in a string. Since here in this case, we are explicitly throwing an exception of type arithmetic exception, and here we do not have any handling code for it. That's how the default handler will print the output. The default handler will print name of the exception, and this is the description of exception, which I just have written in the parentheses while creating a new object of type arithmetic exception. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java. And here in this case, we are creating an object of type null pointer exception. And within the parentheses, we are passing a string I am null. Finally, we are explicitly throwing the exception of type null pointer exception. But in this code, again, we do not have any handling code. Let me try to compile this code. Java C, first.java. Compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. And at the place of description of exception, it's printing I am null. That's all for this video, guys. Don't forget to like and share this video. Subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook, and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. If you want to go for a car journey, then your father may ask if you have an extra tire or not. Means your father want to confirm that if in between the journey your tire get punctured, then you will be able to change your tire or not. You will be able to complete your journey or not. It is possible that your father will not allow you for the journey if you do not have any extra tire. Your father is not allowing you for the journey because you do not have any extra tire. It does not mean 100% your tire is going to be punctured in between the journey. And it also does not mean that your father is creating an exception. Your father is not creating any exception. But he is protecting you from a potential exception which may occur during the journey. Before your journey, your father is just checking if you are able to handle the potential exception in your journey or not. If no, he will not allow you to go on the journey. Compiler plays the role of father when you compile the code. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. In this video, we will learn about checked exception in Java and we will also learn about throws keyword in Java. And yes, throws keyword is very different from throw keyword. Exception is completely a runtime issue. Exception never occurs at the compile time. We already have discussed this point in previous videos of this session. But sometimes, compiler can guess at the compile time that there could be a chance of exception at runtime. In such a situation, if there is no handling code, then compiler throws compile time error that there is a chance of exception, so you must have to implement handling code. Or delegate the handling code implementation to caller of the method using throws keyword. We will practically understand this point in a while. Checked exception means start your journey only if you have an extra tire. Otherwise, do not start your journey. That means if the compiler gets a potential exception at the compile time, then the compiler will not allow the code to compile and the bytecode will not be created. Compiler is just like your father in this case. If you do not have a handling code for the potential exception, it will not allow to run the code. It will not create the bytecode. But it does not mean the exception happened at the compile time. Compiler is just stopping you from the potential exception. But it does not mean that the exception happened at the compile time. Compiler is just saving you from a potential exception which may happen at the runtime. So what are the checked exceptions? Exceptions for which the compiler checks at the compile time if you have proper handling code or not, or you delegate the handling code implementation to caller method using throws keyword or not, are all checked exceptions. So the exceptions for which compiler checks these two things are called checked exceptions. Except runtime exception and its children, and error and its children, all the exceptions are checked exceptions. For example, IO exception and its children are checked exception. SQL exception is a checked exception. Compiler throws error for potential exceptions, that is checked exceptions, in the code if there is a chance of occurrence of such exceptions, The method executing the code with potential exception, which may occur at the runtime, does not have a handling code. In this case, also the compiler throws error. The method executing the code with potential exception does not delegating its code to its caller. So in these three cases, compiler throws error for potential exception in the code. That is, if there is a chance of occurrence of such exceptions, the method executing the code with potential exception does not have the handling code, and the method executing the code with potential exception does not delegate its code to its caller. In these three cases, the compiler generates compile time error and does not compile the code. Till now in this session, whatever exceptions we have seen, all were unchecked. That's why we did not get any compile time error, even in the absence of handler. Means whatever the examples of exception we have seen in this session, arithmetic exception and null pointer exceptions, both were unchecked exceptions. Compiler was not checking for them. Compiler was not checking for them in the code if the method where there is a potential chance for arithmetic exception or null pointer exception is delegating the handling of these exceptions to its caller method or not. These two exceptions are unchecked exceptions. Here we have the Java file first.java, which contains the class first. Inside the class first, we have the method main. And inside the method main, we are creating an object of class printWriter. PrintWriter is a class present in the package java.io. We need to pass the file name in the constructor of PrintWriter. Whenever we use the class PrintWriter, always there is a chance for file not found exception. And this is a checked exception. Compiler checks if your code has the proper handling code for file not found exception or not. Or you are delegating the handling of the exception, file not found exception, to your caller or not. And in this case, we are doing nothing. We do not have handling code for file not found exception, and we are not delegating its handling to the caller. That's how in this case, the compiler at the compile time throws an error and does not create a bytecode. The error thrown by compiler is unreported exception, file not found exception, must be caught or declared to be thrown. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. The compiler will throw an error. The compiler throws the same error as we have seen. Compiler does not check for the handling code of arithmetic exception. It only checks for the handling code of the file not found exception. For this statement, 8 divided by 0, you will get a runtime error. But for this statement, you will get a compile time error. Here we have the Java file first.java, which contains a class whose name is first. Inside the method main of the class first, we have the statement where we are creating an object of type PrintWriter. But at this time, we have enclosed this statement within the try block. We have the handling code for the exception, file not found exception. And at this time, the compiler will not throw any error. Since the class file not found exception is present in the package java.io, so you need to import the class file not found exception from the package java.io. Otherwise, the compiler will not recognize the word file not found exception. If the class file not found exception or the class PrintWriter were in the class java.lang, then here we do not need to import these classes. But these classes are not in the java.lang package. These classes are in java.io package. So we must need to import these classes in our code. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. Java C first.java. It compiles fine and the compiler does not throw any error. A method can delegate the handling responsibility to its caller by using throws keyword. Here in the method definition, after the formal argument parenthesis, we have to write the keyword throws followed by name of the exception which we want to delegate to its caller. The caller of the method main is the JVM. So here the method main delegates the handling of the checked exception, that is file not found exception, to its caller, that is JVM. Main delegates the handling responsibility to its caller, that is the JVM. And we already know that the JVM has default handler. So after this code, the compiler will not throw any error because compiler comes to know that if exception occurs, then it will be handled by the default handler, that is JVM. But you know, the nature of the default handler is to remove the stack frame of the method from the stack and terminate the program abnormally. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, And this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. Java C first.java. At this time it compiles fine. Because the method main delegates the handling responsibility of the exception file not found exception to the JVM. JVM will terminate this program abnormally only if the exception occurs. And in this case, the exception occurs only if it is not possible to create the file abc.txt in the current directory. That means for the checked exceptions, compiler just want to know that how we will handle possible exceptions at the runtime if they occur. Compiler does not compile the code if we do not have proper handling code of possible exception. It does not mean that exception occurs at the compile time. Here in this case, we have the Java file first.java, which contains the class first. Inside the class first, we have three methods: method F1, method F2, and the method main. The execution starts from the method main, and the method main calls the method F1. From inside the method F1, we are calling the method F2. And inside the method F2, we are creating an object of type printWriter with name of the file abc1.txt. Here the method F2 does not have any handling code for file not found exception. And the method F2 is also not delegating the handling of the exception file not found exception to its caller. That's how in this code, the compiler will throw an error: unreported exception file not found exception must be caught or declared to be thrown. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. The compiler will throw an error. Compiler throws an error: unreported exception file not found exception must be caught or declared to be thrown. This is the same code as in the previous slide, but here in this case the method F2 is delegating the handling responsibility of file not found exception to its caller. Caller of the method F2 is the method F1. So the method F2 is delegating the handling responsibility of file not found exception to the method F1. But the method F1 does not have any handling code, or the method F1 is not delegating the handling responsibility to its caller. Method F2 delegates the handling responsibility to the method F1, but the method F1 does not have any handling code, or the method F1 is not delegating the handling responsibility to its caller. In this case, at this statement, where the method F1 calls the method F2, at this statement, the Java C will throw a compile time error: unreported exception, file not found exception, must be caught or declared to be thrown. Let's try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. The compiler will throw an error: Java C first.java. Compiler throws an error: unreported exception file not found exception must be caught or declared to be thrown at the line where the method F1 calls the method F2. Here the method F2 is delegating the handling responsibility of file not found exception to the method F1, that is its caller. And the method F1 is delegating the handling responsibility of file not found exception to the method main, that is its caller. But the method main does not have any handling code, and the method main is also not delegating the handling responsibility of file not found exception to its caller. In this case, the compiler will again throw an error: unreported exception, file not found exception, must be caught or declared to be thrown at this line number where the method main calls the method F1. Let's try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let's compile this code: Java C first.java. The compiler throws an error: unreported exception file not found exception must be caught or declared to be thrown at the line where the method main calls the method F1. Here in this case, the method F2 is delegating its handling responsibility of file not found exception to its caller. Caller of the method F2 is the method F1. The method F1 also delegating the handling responsibility of file not found exception to its caller. Caller of the method F1 is the method main. The method main is also delegating the handling responsibility of file not found exception to its caller. The caller of the method main is JVM. So the default handler of the JVM will handle this exception if the exception occurs. And for creating a printWriter object, the exception will only occur if it is not possible to create a file abc1.txt. So in this case, the code will compile fine, because all the three methods which were responsible for handling the file not found exception are delegating their responsibilities to their callers. method F2 delegates the handling responsibility to the method F1. The method F1 delegates the handling responsibility to the method main. The method main delegates the handling responsibility to its caller, that is the JVM. JVM has default handler. So compiler comes to know that if exception occurs, then it will be handled by default handler and the code will compile fine. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java and this is the same code as we have seen. Let's compile this code. At this time the code will compile fine. The code compiles fine. That's all for this video guys. Don't forget to like and share this video. Subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next. Let's discuss something more about throws keyword. If a method wants to delegate the responsibility of handling of exception to its caller, then it uses throws keyword. After writing the throws keyword, we need to write the exception name as we have seen in this video. But instead of writing the exact exception name, for example file not found exception, we can write the name of the parent class of the given exception. That means after throws keyword, instead of writing file not found exception, we can write IO exception. We can write just exception, or even we can write throwable. Let me try this concept practically. Open first.java and here the exception may occur in the method F2 is file not found exception. But instead of delegating the handling responsibility of file not found exception, we can delegate the handling responsibility of IO exception to the caller of the method F2. And same thing we are doing in the method F1. And same thing we are doing in the method main. To use IO exception in our code, we need to import the exception IO exception. So import it java.io.ioException. Try to compile this code java c first.java. It compiles fine. Even we can use the class exception with the throws keyword. Right here exception. Use here the class exception. Throws exception. Also use here the class exception. Throws exception. Try to compile this code. Java C. First.java. It compiles fine. So we can use any parent of file not found exception here. We can use here throwable. Throws throwable. throwable, throwable. Right here, throws throwable, throw, throwable, and right here, throws throwable, throwable. Try to compile this code java c first.java. It compiles fine. But one thing we cannot do. Once if you have used the parent exception class name with throws keyword, we cannot again use the child exception class name with throws keyword. Let's try it practically. Instead of writing here throwable, let's rewrite here file not found exception. Right here file not found exception. Try to compile this code java c first.java. The compiler throws an error. Unreported exception throwable must be caught or declared to be thrown. So if we have used the parent exception with throws keyword in called method, then we cannot use the child exception with throws keyword in the caller method. That will cause the compile time error. But one thing we can do, if here in the called method we have file not found exception, let's write it here file not found exception. File not found exception, then here we can use IO exception. Here we can use IO exception. And here we can use exception or throwable, because IO exception is parent of file not found exception and throwable is a parent of IO exception. You should notice here that the method F1 is responsible for providing the handling code of IO exception or parent of the IO exception, or it is responsible for delegating the handling of IO exception or its parent exception to its caller methods. Let's try this code practically. Java C, first.java. It compiles fine, so it is working fine. If you go for a car journey, then before you start, your father may ask if you have an extra tire or not. If you do not have an extra tire, then your father may not let you to go for a journey. At this time, your father is checking if you have a handling code for the potential exception during journey or not. But there is one more exception which might occur during the journey. There may be some explosive blast. During your journey, there may be some bomb blast or blast in any type of explosion. But your father never say you before the journey to have a proper bomb suit before you start your car journey. Your father never says like this, although the probability of such type of exception is very low if you are not in a war zone. But the probability of this exception is not zero. Even if the probability of this exception is not zero, your father does not check it if you have a proper bomb suit or not. This type of exception is called unchecked exception. So the exception for which the compiler never checks if you have a handling code or not, such exception is called unchecked exception. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. Possible exceptions for which the compiler does not check that a program has handling codes or not are called unchecked exceptions. Compiler does not generate any error even if the method does not have handling code for the potential exception. Runtime exception and its children and error and its children are unchecked exceptions. Here in this case, the method main will cause an arithmetic exception. And here also we do not have any handling code. But in this case, the compiler will not throw any error because the arithmetic exception is an unchecked exception. At the runtime, the exception will occur and the program will terminate abnormally. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java. And this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. Java C first.java. Even if there is unhandled code for an exception, but the compiler does not throw any error. Now let's run this code. Java first. At runtime, the program terminates abnormally. Exception in thread main, java.lang.arithmetic exception, division by 0. And then it prints the stack trace. This is the output of default handler of JVM. We know that the arithmetic exception class is present in the package java.lang. We can create a new object of type arithmetic exception and can throw that object. So here we are explicitly creating an arithmetic exception and throwing it. If we are explicitly using throw keyword to throw an exception checked or unchecked, then the compiler checks that if there are any extra statement after throw or not. If there is an extra statement after throw, then in this case the compiler will throw an error. Does not matter we are creating an object of type checked exception or unchecked exception. If we are using the throw keyword explicitly to throw an exception, does not matter it is checked or unchecked, and we have some extra quotes after this throw keyword, then the compiler will generate an error. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. Java C first.java. The compiler throws an error, unreachable statement, hi. The compiler already predicted the statement cannot be reached. The program will terminate abnormally at this statement and the statement for printing hi cannot be reached. But if we do not have any extra statement after throw keyword, then the compiler keeps quiet and does not throw any exception. Let me try this program practically. Open first.java once again and comment out this statement. Now we do not have any statement after throw keyword. Try to compile this code. Java C first.java. Compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. At compile time, the compiler keeps quiet and does not throw any error. But at the runtime, the program terminates abnormally. Error and its children are unchecked and also follow the same rule as runtime exception and its children. That means if you are not providing any statement after the throw keyword, then the compiler will keep quiet. And at the runtime, we will get an abnormal termination of the program. But if we have some extra statement after the throw keyword, then the compiler will not keep quiet and it will generate a code unreachable error. That's all for this video, guys. Don't forget to like and share this video, subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook, and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. In this video, we will learn about types of checked exception in Java. There are two types of checked exceptions in Java, fully checked exceptions and partially checked exceptions. Now the question is, what are fully checked exceptions? If an exception E is a checked exception and all children classes of exception E are also checked, then E is called fully checked exception. For example, IO exception. You can see here the IO exception is a checked exception and all the children of IO exception are also checked exceptions. So the IO exception is fully checked exception. Now check, what are the partially checked exceptions? If an exception E is a checked exception and few children classes of the exception E are unchecked exceptions, then the exception E is called partially checked exception. There are only two exceptions which are partially checked, throwable and exception. You can see here the throwable itself is a checked exception, but there are some children of exception which are checked. Means all the classes like IO exception, E of exception, etc. are checked exceptions. But all the classes like runtime exception, arithmetic exception, null pointer exception are unchecked exception. So the throwable itself is a checked exception. There are some classes of the class throwable which are unchecked exception, and there are some classes of the class throwable which are checked exception. So the class throwable is a partially checked exception. And similar is the case with the class exception. The exception itself is a checked exception, but there are some children of the class exception which are unchecked exceptions, and there are some children of the class exception which are checked exceptions. So the class exception is also a partially checked exception. Compiler always checks for the presence of the handling code in Java for all the checked exceptions. Does not matter it is partially checked or fully checked exception. That's how if we are explicitly throwing a throwable with exception description I thrown, and there is no other statement after this statement, in this case the compiler will generate an error and the code will not compile fine. Let me try this code practically. Let's open first.java and this is the same code as we have seen. Let's compile this code, java c first.java. The compiler throws an error, unreported exception throwable must be caught or declared to be thrown. Here the throwable is a partially checked exception, but still the compiler is checking if there is a handling code for this exception or not. Let's open the Java file once again and at this time create an object of type exception and try to throw it. Right here, exception. Here it should be capital E, not a small e. Now try to compile this code, java c first.java. The compiler again throws the same error, at this time for exception. We can use the exception class object with throw keyword. We can use the throwable class object with throw keyword. But we cannot use the object class object with throw keyword. With the throw keyword, we can only use the objects of those classes which are either throwable or children of the throwable. That's all for this video, guys. Don't forget to like and share this video, subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook, and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. In this video, we will learn about some exception handling rules and we will also learn various ways to write try catch finally blocks. If a catch block is intended to catch a fully checked exception, for example, here in this case, the catch block is intended to catch a fully checked exception, that is IO exception. So if a catch block is intended to catch a fully checked exception, then compiler checks its try block for chances of occurrence of corresponding exception. Here the compiler checks if whatever written in the try block of corresponding catch block have any chance to produce IO exception or not. If no, the compiler will result an error and bytecode will not be created. If compiler found that there is no any chance for exception to occur, then compiler generates a compile time error. Here in these two cases, the compiler generates compile time error. Because IO exception and file not found exception, both are fully checked exceptions. And inside the corresponding try blocks of these two catches, there are no any chance to throw IO exception or no any chance to throw file not found exception. They are just printing a string. That's how in these two cases, the compiler generates an error. There is no such check for partially checked exceptions and unchecked exceptions. Here in the catch block, we are ready to handle arithmetic exception. But there is no such statement in the try block of corresponding catch block which may raise arithmetic exception. Still in this case, the compiler does not generate any error because the compiler does not generate such errors for unchecked exceptions and partially checked exceptions. For similar reason, in this case also, the compiler does not generate any error because the exception itself is a partially checked exception. And in this case, the error is an unchecked exception. So there is a compile time error in red colored box because in these cases, compiler checks for possibility of occurrence of exception in try block at the compile time. Green color boxes compile well because compiler does not perform any check at the compile time. There are some rules of writing try, catch and finally blocks in our code. And one of them is try without catch and or finally is not allowed. Here we have a catch block corresponding to the try block. So this is allowed in Java. Here we have a try block corresponding to the finally block. So this one is also allowed in Java. But here in this case, the try block is alone. There is no corresponding catch or finally blocks. So this one is compile time error. Try without catch or finally is not allowed. Similarly, catch without try or finally without try are not allowed. Here we have a try block corresponding to this catch block. But in this case, we have a second catch block and corresponding to this catch block, we do not have any try block. So in between these two catch blocks, we have a system.out.println statement which prints hi. That's how the second catch block here is the catch without try. This statement results an error. Here in this case, there are two compile time errors. There is no catch corresponding to this try and there is no try corresponding to this catch. So these two try and catch blocks result errors. Similarly, in this case, we have finally without any try. In between catch and finally, there is a separate statement which actually kicks out the finally from the group of try, catch, finally. Here in this case, we have the group of try, catch, finally, but there is one another finally and this finally is out of the group. That's how this finally is considered as without try. Here in this case, there is finally corresponding to a try and the catch block cannot be after the finally block. In this case, the catch block is considered as out of the group and the compiler will result an error. There can be more than one catch blocks corresponding to a try. We will learn about this concept in the coming videos of this session. But the two catch blocks of the same try should not catch the same exception. That will result a compile time error. The compiler will say exception XYZ already has been caught. We can have another try catch block in both try and catch blocks. We can have separate try catch finally block groups in any try catch or finally blocks. Here in this case, inside a try block, we have only one try block and there is no corresponding catch block of it. That's how in this case, the compiler will throw an error. Try without catch. This inner try is without catch. Outer try is with catch, but the inner try is without catch. So these are the some rules of writing try catch finally blocks in our code. That's all for this video guys. Don't forget to like and share this video. Subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and we are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. In this video, we will learn the concept of try block with multiple catch blocks. We can have multiple catch blocks corresponding to a try block. Till now in this session, we have seen only one catch block corresponding to one try block, but we can have multiple catch blocks corresponding to a try block. And one more point to be noticed here is, we can catch a child class exception object in its parent class reference variable. This is the Java file first.java which contains the class first. Inside the class first, we have the method main which contains a try block with multiple catch blocks. One catch block is ready to catch an exception of type arithmetic exception and another catch block is ready to catch an exception of type file not found exception. Inside the try block, we are writing two statements. One statement may generate file not found exception at the runtime and other statement will definitely generate the arithmetic exception at the runtime. And we are ready to catch these two exceptions in two different catch blocks. When we compile this Java file, then the compiler will not throw any error because we have the handling code for file not found exception. And at the execution time, this is very less probability to get a file not found exception. You can have file not found exception only if you are not able to create the file abc.txt. But here in the second case, definitely we will get the arithmetic exception. So after this statement, the control will go to the catch block, which will print the string AE. Let me try to compile this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Now let's compile this code. Java C first.java compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It runs fine and printing the string AE. Order of occurrence of various catch blocks does not matter if various exceptions inside different catch parameters do not have parent-child relationship. Here the class file not found exception and the class arithmetic exception do not have any parent-child relationship. So these two catch blocks can be in any order. In the earlier case, the catch block with arithmetic exception was before the catch block of file not found exception. But here, the catch block with arithmetic exception is after the catch block with file not found exception. It does not matter because these two classes are not related to each other with parent-child relationship. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java and move this catch block above this catch block. Now try to compile this code. It will compile fine. Orders of the catch block does not matter. Now run it. It runs fine and printing the same output. As long as these two classes are not related to each other, whatever inside the parentheses of various catch blocks are not related to each other, the order of the catch blocks does not matter. But if the classes inside the parentheses of the catch blocks are in parent-child relationship, then order of the occurrence of various catch blocks matters. Order of occurrence of various catch blocks matters if any two exceptions inside catch parameters have parent-child relationship. If a catch block containing parent exception in its parameter is before the catch block containing child exception in its parameter, then the child exception can be caught in the catch block who has parent exception in its parameter. And the catch block containing child exception in its parameter becomes just a repetition of the previous one. Hence, in this case, the compiler will throw an error. Here the exception class runtime exception is the parent of the exception class arithmetic exception. So even if in the try block we will get an exception of type arithmetic exception, but that will be caught into the reference variable E of type runtime exception. So an arithmetic exception can be caught in the first catch block, and the second catch block, which is actually ready for catching the arithmetic exception, becomes just a repetition of previous one. That's how in this case the compiler will throw an error, and it will say exception arithmetic exception has already been caught. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code, and at this time the compiler will throw an error. The compiler throws an error: exception arithmetic exception has already been caught in this catch block. If a catch block containing the child exception in its parameter is before the catch block containing parent exception in its parameter, then in this case the compiler will not throw any error and the program will compile fine. Here in this case the arithmetic exception class is a child class of the class runtime exception. So in this case the compiler will not throw any error. Let's try this code practically. Open first.java and cut the last catch block, paste it before the previous one. Now try to compile this code. Java C first.java compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It runs fine and printing AE. Since we can catch child class exception object into the parent class reference, so catching all the Java exceptions in reference variable of type exception is perfectly valid. That's how whatever is thrown by the try block can be cached into a catch block with a reference variable of type exception in its parameter. Similarly, a method can delegate the handling of any exception to its caller method by using the throws keyword followed by the class name exception. That's all for this video, guys. Don't forget to like and share this video. Subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook, and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching this session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. In this video, we will learn about customized exceptions. Till now in this session, we already have learned about the ready-made exceptions present in Java APIs. We cannot confine ourselves only to exception classes provided by JDK. Suppose if we are creating an application for an institute where a student gets marks less than 30 is not allowed to take admission, and students cannot get more marks than 100. In the first case, we need to generate fail exception. Means if an student gets a marks less than 30, then we need to generate fail exception. And in the second case, we need to generate invalid marks exception. That means if a student gets marks more than 100, we need to generate invalid marks exception. And we know that there are no such exceptions provided in Java APIs. Of course, we need to create our own exception classes for this situation. And whenever we create a new exception class for us, the class path to be specified for the newly created exception classes. So now the question is, how to create an exception class? We will create a normal class and change it into an exception class. Now the another question is, how a normal class becomes an exception class? If we inherit a normal class from Throwable or any child of Throwable, then the normal class becomes an exception class. We know that we have the class Throwable and all the exception classes actually the child class of this Throwable. So if we inherit a normal class from Throwable or any child of the Throwable, then the normal class becomes an exception class. After creating an exception class, we can throw the newly created exception class. We have the Java file first.java, which contains three classes, the class fail exception, the class invalid marks exception, and the class first. And you can see here, the class fail exception and the class invalid marks exception extends from the class throwable. So these two classes are children of the throwable. Since these two classes are children of the throwable, we can use these classes as exception. We can throw objects of these classes like exception. Inside the class first, we have the method main, which throws fail exception and invalid mask exception. Here the method main is delegating the responsibility of handling of these two exception, fail exception and invalid mask exception, to its caller. That means the method main is delegating the responsibility of handling these exception to the JVM. We are checking if whatever is stored by the variable marks is less than 30 or not. If the marks is less than 30, then this if block will execute. If the marks is greater than 100, then this else if block will execute. Otherwise, in rest of the cases, this else block will execute. So here the value of the variable marks is 5. That's how the if block will execute. Inside the if block, we are creating an object of type fail exception with the parameter to its parameterized constructor as urFail. So the reference of this string gets stored into the string variable s in the parameter of the parameterized constructor of the class fail exception. And inside the body of the parameterized constructor of the class fail exception, we are calling the constructor of its parent, that is constructor of throwable, with the same string. That's how in this case the exception occurs, which is not handled by the method main. The method actually delegates the handling of exception to its caller, that is JVM. The fail exception occurs and the JVM calls its default handler. The default handler of the JVM prints exception in thread main, fail exception, and the description of the exception, that is urFail. If the value of the variable marks is greater than 100, then the main will throw the exception, invalid marks exception, with the exception description as enter again. And same thing occurs for this situation, what happened with the marks is equal to 5. And if the value of the marks is between 30 and 100, then it will print got it. In this case, there will not be any exception. So here we have created our own customized exception and used it. We extended our created exceptions from throwable, that's why they become checked exceptions. These two exceptions become checked exceptions. That means if the method main does not delegate the handling of these two exceptions to its caller, then the compiler will throw an error. That means if we inherit our customized exceptions from partially or fully checked exceptions, then they become checked exceptions. Let us try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code, Java C first.java, and it compiles fine. Now run it, Java first. The JVM throws an exception in thread main, urFail. But at this time, the JVM is throwing our customized exception, not ready-made exception. Let's change somewhat in this code, and let's remove this throw statement. I do not want the method main to delegate the handling of the exceptions to its caller. So remove this throw statements. Remove it. Now try to compile this code. What will happen here? We do not have any handling code for these two exceptions. And the method main is not delegating the handling of these two exceptions to its caller. So the compiler will not let you to compile this code and create a bytecode. Because the fail exception and invalid marks exception both are checked exceptions. So let's compile this code. Try to compile it. The compiler throws an error. Unreported exception, fail exception. must be caught or declared to be thrown. And the compiler throws another error, the unreported exception, invalid marks exception, must be caught or declared to be thrown. Normal approach to make the customized exception unchecked by inheriting it from an unchecked exception. Usually people inherit customized exceptions from runtime exception to make them unchecked exception. Here the fail exception and invalid marks exception both are unchecked exceptions because both extends runtime exception. And in this case, inside the method main of the class first, we do not have any handling code for these exceptions. And also the method main is not delegating the handling responsibility to its caller. But since in this code, the exceptions fail exception and invalid marks exception both are unchecked exceptions, that's how the compiler will not throw any error. But at the runtime, the program will stop abnormally. Here in this case, since the value of the variable marks is 102, that's why the invalid marks exception occurs. Let's try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. Java C, first.java. Compiler does not throw any error because both the exceptions are unchecked exceptions now. Now run it. Java first. The program stopped execution abnormally by throwing an exception. Exception in thread main, invalid marks exception. And the description of exception is enter again. Here if the marks is in between 30 and 100, then this program will not throw any exception. In this case, the program will compile fine. And also the program will run fine. Let's open first.java once again. Here in this case the marks is 102. And let me try to handle the exception. Let's put these two statements, throw new fail exception and throw new invalid marks exception, in between the try catch blocks. Put them, try, fail exception, followed by try, we should have a catch right here, catch, catch. Fail exception, variable e, and then give opening and closing brackets for the catch block. I am writing nothing inside the catch block. After that, put this statement in between the try, try, then your try body is over. After that, put a catch body. Followed by this try, we should put a catch body. Again, inside the catch body, we are writing nothing. But here we should catch the invalid marks exception. Invalid marks exception. Now let's compile this code. Java C, first.java. INVALID. There is a typo. INVALID. Now again try to compile this code. Java C, first.java. Compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It should be capital F. It runs fine and printing nothing because the exception invalid marks exception occurs and inside the catch block we are printing nothing. That's all for this video guys. Don't forget to like and share this video, subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. There are many exception classes and many error classes are present in Java support system. We will learn about all these classes with corresponding topics. But in this video, I am going to introduce you with few exception classes and few error classes. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. Some well-known exceptions and errors are null pointer exception, stack overflow error, no class def found error, class cast exception, exception initializer error. Let's see few of them. So there are two children of throwable class, the exception class and the error class. And we are going to learn about few classes which are either children of exception or the children of error. The first one we are going to learn is null pointer exception. If we try to perform operation on a reference variable containing null, then this exception occurs. The class null pointer exception is a child class of the class runtime exception and raised automatically by JVM. We already have seen the occurrence of null pointer exception in the previous videos of Java and Web. We also have seen the null pointer exception when we tried to throw null. In that case, the JVM raised this exception. Let's try to generate the exception null pointer exception in a code. Here we have two Java files, first.java and second.java. Let's open second.java, and in the second.java we have the method void, and inside the method void we are printing the string second ABCD. Then we have another file, first.java. Let's open first.java. In the first.java we have the reference variable s of type second, which contains reference of an object of type second. But in the next statement we are storing the value null to the reference variable s. Then after we are calling the method ABCD by using the reference variable s. Since the variable s contains null, so this statement generates null pointer exception because there is null stored in the reference variable s. It is not reference of any object of type second. It is just null stored into the reference variable s. Let me try to compile these two codes. Java C, first.java, and second.java. Compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. You can see here the JVM throws an exception. Exception in thread main java.lang.nullPointerException. Then we have stack overflow error. If our method call fall into infinite calls to the same or different methods, then JVM generates this error. The class stack overflow error is a child class of the class error. Hence it is unchecked exception. We already have a video on stack overflow error in Java and Web. Here in this case the method main is calling itself endlessly. So in this case the JVM will throw an exception. Exception in thread main java.lang.stackOverflowError. Here in this case the method main is calling the method ABCD, and the method ABCD is calling the method main. So both are calling each other endlessly. That's how in this case we again have exception in thread main java.lang.stackOverflowError. We already have seen such examples in the previous videos of Java and Web. After subscribing this channel, hit the bell icon to get notified about all the videos by my name is Gyan. Here you will get complete, comprehensive and animated series on Java and Web, which covers more than 90% of Java AC and Java EE. And don't forget to like this video and make the thumbs up color blue. Then we have another exception, class not found exception. This exception generated by JVM when required class definition is not found. If we pass the invalid class name which does not exist to the JVM, then the JVM throws such exception, the class not found exception. Here you can see we do not have any class file. We have only two Java files, first.java and second.java. That's how if we try to pass the name of the class to the JVM will throw an exception. Type here Java first. The class whose name is first does not exist here in the current directory. That's how the JVM will throw an exception. The JVM throws an exception, error, could not find or load main class first. java.lang.classNotFoundException. Let's compile both Java files and create class files for both. Type here Java C, first.java and second.java. .java. Press enter. Okay, the name of the second should be capital S. I typed it wrong. Type here capital S. Press enter. It compiles fine, and you can see here we have two class files, first.class and second.class. Now let's execute the class first, Java first. It throws the null pointer exception because of our code. Let's change the code of first.java and remove this statement, s is equal to null. Remove this one. Now compile the both files again. Clear the screen and now try to run the class first. It runs fine and printing second ABCD. But here in this case we have both class files in the current directory. What if I remove the class file second.class from the current directory? In that case also, the class first will try to search for the class second. And in that case, the JVM will throw in another type of error. Let's remove second.class from the current directory. Rm second.class. I removed the class file second.class from the current directory. Now try to run the class first. Java first. At this time, the JVM throws an error. java.lang.noClassDefFoundError. The class second is not found at the runtime, not at the compile time. If at the compile time the class file second.class was not present, then we were not able to compile the file first.java. After subscribing this channel, hit the bell icon to get notified about all the videos by My Name is Gyan. Here you will get complete, comprehensive and animated series on Java and web, which covers more than 90% of Java AC and Java EE. And don't forget to like this video and make the thumbs up color blue. Now we have another type of exception called class cast exception. We already have seen this slide in another video named typecasting of reference variables in Java. So these are the rules of typecasting of reference variables. And the third rule is the underlying object type of D, means whatever the reference is stored in the reference variable D, must be either same or drive type of C. Otherwise, we will get a runtime exception called class cast exception. The link of the video discussing typecasting of reference variables is given in the video description below. The class classCast exception is a child class of the class runtime exception. Hence, it is an unchecked exception. After subscribing this channel, hit the bell icon to get notified about all the videos by My Name is Gyan. Here you will get complete, comprehensive and animated series on Java and web, which covers more than 90% of Java AC and Java EE. And don't forget to like this video and make the thumbs up color blue. Now we have some JVM based exceptions. JVM based exceptions are caused by JVM automatically at runtime. Runtime exception and its children are JVM based exception. The JVM based exceptions are always unchecked. So here in this case, the runtime exception and its children are JVM based exception. All are unchecked exceptions. Then we have programmatic exceptions, also called customized exceptions. We already have discussed about customized exceptions in the previous video of this session. Exception which raised by programmer or API developers are called programmatic exceptions. It may be checked or unchecked, depends on how a programmer is creating them. Customized exceptions are programmatic exceptions. Then we have errors. Error is not supposed to handle by programmer. Error should be handled by user of a program. For example, if an user of the program is running the program on a machine with very low configuration, then in that case he may get out of memory error or a stack overflow error very easily. That's all for this video guys. Don't forget to like and share this video. Subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. After subscribing this channel, hit the bell icon to get notified about all the videos by My Name is Gyan. Here you will get complete, comprehensive and animated series on Java and web, which covers more than 90% of Java AC and Java EE. And don't forget to like this video and make the thumbs up color blue. In the session 11 of Java and web, we already have learned about the equals method of java.lang.object class. Now in this video, we are going to override the equals method of java.lang.object class. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching this session 12 of Java and web, exception handling in Java. We know that all the methods of java.lang.object are present in all the classes in Java. So the equals method is also present in all the classes in Java. Here in this case, we have a Java file whose name is student.java, which contains the class student. In the class student, we have an instance variable role of type integer and we have an instance variable name of type string. Then we have a parameterized constructor. The parameterized constructor is expecting two parameters, one parameter role of type integer and other parameter name of type string. Whatever the value passed to the integer role will be stored into the instance variable role of the class student. And whatever the value passed to the variable name will be stored into the instance variable name of the class student. Now in the class student, we started to override the method equals. We have multiple catch blocks followed by this try block. Inside the try block, the variable O of type object first gets typecasted into the class student. And then whatever the reference is stored into the reference variable O gets stored into the reference variable S of type student. This statement may cause two types of exceptions. The first one is class cast exception and the second one is null pointer exception. We know that when an object whose reference is stored into the reference variable O is not of the same type or derived type of the class student, then in this case this statement will result a class cast exception. We already have learned this concept in the previous videos of Java and Web. The link of all those videos are given in the video description below. So if the class cast exception occurs, then we have a corresponding catch block. Inside the catch block, we are returning false. Means if class cast exception occurs, then our program will not terminate abnormally. Instead, the method equals will return false. Similarly, if the reference variable O contains null, then the null also will be stored into the reference variable S. In that case, trying to access the instance variable name or instance variable role by using the reference variable S will cause null pointer exception. So we should be ready to catch null pointer exception. So the catch block where null pointer exception occurs returns false. So in that case, where reference variable O contains null, the method equals will return false. Inside the if parenthesis, we are checking if the instance variable name is equal to the name corresponding to the variable O or not. Since whatever the reference is stored into the reference variable O is now stored into the reference variable S. So indirectly we are checking here if the instance variable name of the caller object is equal to instance variable name of an object whose reference is stored into the reference variable O or not. And similarly here we are checking if the instance variable role of the caller object is equal to instance variable role of an object whose reference is stored into the reference variable O or not. If both are equals, means name equals name and role equals role, then the method equals will return true. Otherwise, the method equals will return false. Now check here in this case, we have a Java file first.java which contains the class first. Inside the method main of the class first, we are creating two objects of type student. And both objects contain the same content. Both objects has role equal to 5 and name is Gyan. The reference of two objects are stored into the reference variables S and S1. After that, we are creating an object of type object whose reference is stored into the reference variable O. Then in the system.out.println, we are calling the method equals of the class student by using the reference variable S1. And the actual argument we pass to the method equals is the reference variable S. That's how the S will be copied into the object reference O and caller of the equals method is S1. So here we are checking if the name field of an object whose address is stored into the reference variable S1 is equal to the name field of an object whose address is stored into the reference variable S or not. And similarly here we are checking the role field of an object whose address is stored into the reference variable S1 is equal to the role field of an object whose reference is stored into the reference variable S or not. If these two are equal, then the method equals will return true. If these two are not equal, then the method equals will return false. In this case, the method equals will return true. That's how here we are printing true. In the next case, we are calling the method equals by using the reference variable S1 and we are passing null as the actual argument. That's how in this case, we get null pointer exception. And since the statement in the catch block corresponding to null pointer exception is returned false. That's how here we will get false. After that, we are checking if S1 equals O or not. Here in the third case, we will get class cast exception. Because in the reference variable O, we do not have a reference of type a student or any child of a student. We have the reference of type object. That's how this will result false. Let's try this code practically. Open student.java and this is the same code as we have seen. Then open first.java and this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. Java C, student.java and first.java. It's compiled fine. Now run it. Java first. It runs fine and printing true, false and false. If we do not handle the class cast exception and null pointer exception in the overridden equals method of the class student, then we must have to face the runtime exception. Let's make some changes in the code. Open student.java and remove this catch block. Remove these two catch blocks. Remove them. Now remove the try block. So our code is not under any try block. We are not handling the potential exceptions. Now open first.java. And here in this case, we will get a null pointer exception. And in this case, we will get a class cast exception. But since the first statement will get a null pointer exception, then after the execution of the program will be terminated. So here we will get just null pointer exception. Let me try to compile this code. It compiles fine. Now run it. Java first and exception in thread main java.lang.nullPointerException. Let's make some changes in first.java and take this statement above previous one. Now let's try to compile it once again. Java C student.java first.java. It's compiled fine. Now run it. Java first. At this time, exception in thread main java.lang.classCastException. java.base java.lang.object cannot be cast to a student. So in this case, we are handling both exceptions and returning false by equals method when any of the exception occurs. That's all for this video, guys. Don't forget to like and share this video, subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook, and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. After subscribing this channel, hit the bell icon to get notified about all the videos by my name is Gyan. Here you will get complete, comprehensive, and animated series on Java and Web, which covers more than 90% of Java AC and Java EE. And don't forget to like this video and make the thumbs up color blue. Although we are going to discuss this topic in later sessions of Java and Web, but in this video I am going to introduce you with the concept of try with resources. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. Whenever we open a resource like file, network connection, etc., we need to close it in finally block. Otherwise, the resource gets blocked. But in try with resource, the open resource in the try gets closed automatically. This concept came in 1.7 version of Java, also known as Java 7. Here in this case, this is a kind of pseudocode. This is not an actual code which can be run by Java. Here we have first.java which contains the class first. Inside the class first, we have the method main. Inside the method main, we have a try block followed by catch block and followed by finally block. Here you can notice we have the parenthesis with try block. The R1, R2 and R3 are different resources opened in try parenthesis. These resources may be open file, open network connection or open a database connection, etc. These resources are auto-closable, means the resources will be automatically closed after use. The file will be automatically closed after use. The network connection will be automatically closed after use. So if you are opening a resource inside the parenthesis of try, then the resource should be auto-closable. To become auto-closable, resources should implement java.lang.autoclosable interface. This interface has only one method, close. When we start to use try with resources, with auto-closable resources, we do not require finally block. So in this case, only try block, without catch block, without finally block is perfectly valid statement. We will see more about this concept with files, networks and databases. Even whole exception handling concept will be revised with files, networks and databases. That's all for this video, guys. Don't forget to like and share this video, subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next. After subscribing this channel, hit the bell icon to get notified about all the videos by my name is Gyan. Here you will get complete, comprehensive and animated series on Java and Web, which covers more than 90% of Java AC and Java EE. And don't forget to like this video and make the thumbs up color blue. Namaste everyone, I am Gyan and you are watching the session 12 of Java and Web, Exception Handling in Java. In this video, we will learn about multi-catch block in Java. If different exceptions have same handling codes, like in this case, we have handling codes for two exceptions, arithmetic exception and IO exception. But both handling codes are same, both are printing high. So in such cases, we need to catch all the different exceptions in different catch blocks. And we need to rewrite the handling code again and again. But with multi-catch block, we can implement all of them in single catch. So here in this case, we are catching the arithmetic exception and IO exception, both in same catch. And when you write the names of two or more exceptions, you need to write here OR symbol. Two exception names should be separated by OR symbols. And then you need to write here just one reference variable for both the exceptions. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Let me try to compile this code. Java C, first.java, compiles fine. Now run it. Java first. It runs fine and printing high. But if you have only one catch block for more than one exceptions, then these exceptions cannot be in parent-child relationship. Multi-catch block cannot handle two exceptions if they are in parent-child relationship. Here the arithmetic exception and runtime exception are in parent-child relationship. That's how in this case the compiler will throw an error. Let me try this code practically. Open first.java, and this is the same code as we have seen. Try to compile this code. The compiler throws the same error. Alternatives in multi-cache statement cannot be related by subclassing. Alternative arithmetic exception is a subclass of alternative runtime exception. If a cache block handles more than one exceptions altogether, then the size of the bytecode corresponding to this cache block will be lesser than bytecodes of two cache blocks handling these two exceptions separately. That's how a cache block handling more than one exceptions together is superior than the cache blocks handling exceptions separately. Actually, if you look the Java code carefully, then only one exception can occur in the try block, because after occurrence of one exception, the try block stops execution and the other statements of the try block do not execute. In this case, only one exception can occur in one try block. Then after, even if there is a potential for exception in the next statements, but these statements are not going to execute, so their exceptions are not going to be raised. That's how, whatever the exception occurs in the try block, the variable e becomes a reference variable of that type. In this case, the variable e becomes a reference variable of arithmetic exception type. If you write the statement here, e.getMessage, e.getMessage, try to execute this code, Java C, first.java, it compiles fine, now run it, Java first, it runs fine, and you can see here, the description of the exception is division by zero. So arithmetic exception occurs in this case. But if you are using a catch block handling multiple exceptions, then in that case, the reference variable of an exception becomes final variable. Means you cannot change the content of reference variable e in the body of the catch block. If you write here, e is equal to new arithmetic exception, then in this case the compiler will throw an error. Let's try to compile this code. You can check here, the compiler throws an error. Multi-catch parameter e may not be assigned. So in the case of the catch block which handles more than one exception, the reference variable e becomes implicitly final. But if the catch is not handling the multiple exception, then in that case, let's copy it and paste it above. This catch is handling the exception, arithmetic exception, and this catch is handling the exception, IO exception. Remove this line from the second catch. Try to compile this code. At this time, it will compile fine. Compile it. It compiles fine. Now run it. It runs fine. We are getting the output of e.getMessage as null because we are assigning a reference of new arithmetic exception object into the reference variable e, and description of this new arithmetic exception object is null. Let's do some more experiment and open first.java. Here we are catching three exceptions. In the catch block parenthesis, we have three exceptions, and for all the three exceptions, we have only one reference variable e. These all three exceptions are not related to each other. They do not have any parent-child relationship. That's how this multi-cache block is perfectly valid. Let's try to compile this code. Java C, first.java, compiles fine, now run it. Java first, it runs fine and printing high. The arithmetic exception occurs, which has been caught in the catch block. That's all for this video, guys. Don't forget to like and share this video. Subscribe my channel on YouTube, like my page on Facebook, and leave your valuable comments in the comment section below. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video.